Vulture isn't Vulture. I know what you're thinking. Okay, you've already done Hela isn't Hela, Ego isn't Ego, and Zemo isn't Zemo. Is there no end? What can I say? The Marvel villains, and apparently especially the really good ones, aren't all that much like their comic counterparts. The heroes almost always are, but the villains seem to be just kind of built around those heroes. The writers pick and choose the parts of other characters that would make a compelling antagonist and mash them together to make a new one. And maybe no one is more not their comic counterparts than Spider-Man Homecoming's Vulture. It's just... It's pretty amazing how much this guy is everyone but Vulture. And listen, do I love Michael Keaton's Adrian Toomes? Of course. He's probably my favorite single Marvel villain. So funny, so frightening, and just so human. He was great. But he wasn't really Vulture, not the one from the comics. So in this video, I'm going to go over the five other comic characters that make up the Vulture. And I guess if you want to count Vulture himself, that's six, because sure, Vulture is Vulture. How? His name is Adrian Toomes, and he flies in a bird costume, and he's from New York, he's bald, kind of. Is this bald? Nah, not really. He has a green color scheme. He's not really bald. That's kind of it. So let's move to character number two. Spider-Man villains are notorious for also knowing Peter Parker. Because New York City is a city with eight people in it, right? A co-worker becomes Venom. A classmate becomes the other Venom. His best friend is the Hobgoblin. Sometimes the Sandman even killed his dad uncle. And Vulture from the comics isn't really any of those things. He doesn't know Peter pre-vulturing. Adrian Toomes is just a guy that builds a vulture suit and uses it to do crimes. It's a little more complicated than that, we'll get to it. But the whole friend's dad is actually a supervillain thing feels a lot more like the second character on this list, Norman Osborn, aka the Green Goblin. And yeah, there have been other times where someone is related to one of Peter or Miles' friends or love interests or something like that. In fact, someone almost always manages to be related to someone super important to Spider-Man. Gwen's dad is the captain of the NYPD. Betty Brant's brother was the Crime Master, cool name. Black Cat's dad was the Cat. MJ's really the only one that I can't find a significant family member for. But anyway, I'm picking Gobby specifically, because I think in the comics and in the films, Peter's relationship with Norman, and eventually Harry, creates some unique tension. Characters are at Thanksgiving dinner together, discovering each other's secret identities, but unable to do anything about it, out of fear that they'll expose their own and endanger those around them. The dad talk in Spider-Man Homecoming is a great example of that special relationship, and using it to create an unbelievable amount of tension. Easily one of my five top MCU scenes. And it plays out a lot like this scene from Spider-Man Life Story by Chip Zdarsky. Peter is at a bar celebrating Flash's enlistment in the Vietnam War, and Norman tells Peter that he knows Peter's Spider-Man, and he's planted pumpkin bombs all over the bar. Norman forces Peter to pretend nothing is wrong and leave the bar so they can go fight outside. And that kind of dynamic isn't necessarily exclusive to the Green Goblin, but he is the most significant spider foe to put Peter in that position that Toomes does in Homecoming. So I think that aspect of Peter and Norman's relationship was absolutely considered for Peter and Toomes in this movie. Number 3. Speaking of secret identities, another thing that was changed about MCU Toomes' secret identity was his profession. In the comics, Toomes is an inventor who creates a flight suit which gives him superhuman strength and sometimes the ability to drain people of their life force. He is betrayed by his business partner and goes on a revenge spree, also very goblin. Although this happens pretty often with Spider-Man villains. But in Spider-Man Homecoming, Toomes is the owner of a salvage company. While there isn't a Spider-Man villain that does that job exactly, there is someone who comes close. Hobart Brown is a villain in Marvel Comics known as the Prowler. And I know what you're thinking. Wait, isn't the Prowler Aaron Davis, Miles Morales' uncle? Yes and no. Aaron Davis is the Prowler, but Miles comes from the Ultimate Universe, which is different from the mainline comic universe. The regular universe is number 616, Ultimate is 1610. I mean, it doesn't matter because the Ultimate Universe doesn't exist anymore, and some of those characters, including Miles, got transferred over to 616. But anyway, in the traditional Marvel Comics canon, the first Prowler is a kid named Hobie Brown. He gets some gear, does some crimes, feels bad, and then stops doing crimes. And Hobie eventually gets a job as a construction worker, which is kind of like a salvager. It's the type of blue-collar work that the Vulture does in the MCU that the Vulture in the comics would not be caught dead doing. And some of Spider-Man's villains are that kind of salt-of-the-earth guy. Sandman is another good example of a character who's usually just a normal guy who gets superpowers. But Vulture never really fills that role. Number 4. Speaking of being an inventor. In the comics, Toomes created his own flight suit. He is a genius engineer. But that's not how it goes down in the movies. In Spider-Man Homecoming, Phineas Mason, aka the Tinkerer, creates Toomes' Vulture suit for him. Now, in the comics, the Tinkerer has aligned with a lot of villains and designed or improved their equipment. He created, among others, one of Mysterio's suits, Rocket Racer Skateboard, Big Wheels Big Wheel, Goldbug's Ship, Whirlwind's Armor, Diamondback's Throwing Diamonds, not that one, a different one, Grim Reaper's Scythe, Grizzly's Grizzly Suit, Killer Shrike's Gauntlets, as well as things for the Animan, Beetle, Black Cat, Blacklash, Blizzard, Boomerang, Constrictor, Jack-O-Lantern, Jester, Hammerhead, Mad Thinker, Owl, Porcupine, Ringer, Stiltman, Spymaster, and Taskmaster. But, as far as I can tell, the Tinkerer never did any significant work for the Vulture. The only time the pair really worked together, the Vulture kidnapped the Tinkerer and forced Mason to open a device that the police were using to contain the supervillain Nitro. In fact, in that issue, New Mutants 86, Toomes even remarks that he is angry that Mason stole his designs for a flight harness. So yeah, when it comes to inventing equipment, all of these spider foes go to the Tinkerer, but not Toomes. Number 5. This one is a little different from the others. In Spider-Man Homecoming, Vulture and Spider-Man get in a fight in a warehouse. Toomes ends the fight by destroying all of the columns supporting the roof, which collapses on Peter. We then get a scene where Peter, nearly crushed by the weight of the building, manages to psych himself up and lift the roof so that he can escape. That moment is a recreation of a classic Spider-Man comic moment from the arc If This Be My Destiny. It took place over issues 31, 32, and 33 of Amazing Spider-Man in 1965. And aside from being notable because it was the first appearance of Gwen Stacy and Harry Osborn, it is also where we get this image from. If This Be My Destiny might be the most Spider-Man of any Silver Age Spider-Man story. Like, it's just pure Spider-Man. In this arc, Peter starts foiling the crimes of a new gang run by someone calling themselves the Master Planner. Peter also starts college, and Aunt May gets sick and nearly dies. The story is about how Peter struggles to have it all. Peter needs to make sacrifices to keep his complicated life going, and just when it seems like things can't get any worse, Aunt May comes down with radiation poisoning from a blood transfusion she got from Peter. There are girl troubles, school troubles, money troubles, everything is crashing down around Spider-Man. And then, during a fight with Doc Ock, who turns out to be the Master Planner, everything literally crashes down around Spider-Man. Doc Ock, not Vulture, has a fight with Spidey that ends up destroying all of the columns supporting the ceiling, and Peter is trapped under the rubble. All is lost. But Spider-Man never gives up. He thinks about all of the people he cares about who count on him, and lifts the metal structure off of him for long enough to escape. And that moment is mirrored in Homecoming, to the same effect. And you could only get there with this Vulture, not a genius inventor, just a working man who knows Peter personally and can put him in a terrible situation so Peter can overcome the challenges and grow. Vulture is clever and relatable and ruthless. He just isn't Vulture. And that's okay. Oh, and I did say there would be 6 characters, 5 other comic influences for Homecoming's Adrian Toomes. Well, I saved the weirdest one for last, and it doesn't have that much to do with the character, but it was too interesting to ignore. I've already talked about something called the Ultimate Universe before, and in this video. Basically, it was a universe-wide relaunch around the 2000s that ran parallel to the normal Marvel Comics continuity. Owen Likes Comics has done many excellent videos on the topic, I'll link a few in this description. Anyway, so they reimagined their characters. Some had more drastic changes than others. Liz Allen's change was pretty drastic. She actually turned out to be a mutant and developed what are pretty much Human Torch powers. And when she did, Magneto came around and said, Liz, you're a mutant and you have a famous father. And everyone said, oh, you? And Magneto said, no, I get now why you think that. I probably should have done a better job with the phrasing, but no, it's one of my friends. And everyone asked, well, which one? And Magneto says, he wants to tell you himself. And everyone went, oh, that doesn't sound like a good sign. So even though she didn't have any famous supervillain father in the comics, Liz Allen actually had a famous supervillain father in the Ultimate Comics. Who, you ask? Take a guess. Write your guess down. On some paper. Or in the comments. No peeking. Okay. You ready for this one? It turned out, Liz's father abandoned her as a child, and she was raised by her mother and occasionally her Uncle Frank. It turns out there was no secret father. Uncle Frank was actually just her father all along. And Frank is short for Franklin Dukes. That's right. Liz Allen. This Liz Allen is the daughter of the Blob. So, in the Ultimate Universe, the Blob abandoned his daughter and forced her mother to raise her on her own. That's pretty messed up. But hey, at least it is not as bad as the time Blob ate the Wasp. And hey, do you have another character who you think bears no similarities to their comic counterparts? Leave it in the comments. Or better yet, make your own video on the subject. You don't know how to make videos, you say? Don't worry. There are a ton of great classes to help you stay creative, and this video's sponsor, Skillshare. On Skillshare, you can watch classes like Jordy Vanderput's classes on editing and Premiere, the program I happen to use, and Thomas Frank's new class on productivity for creators. They're great fundamentals for understanding the creative process that goes into making videos like these. For those of you who don't know, Skillshare is an online learning community that offers membership with meaning. With so much to explore, real projects to create, and the support of fellow creatives, Skillshare empowers you to accomplish real growth. There are classes in productivity, design, writing, video editing, so much more. Skillshare offers classes designed for real life, so you can move your creative journey forward without putting life on hold. You can learn and grow with short classes to fit your busy routine. Skillshare is also incredibly affordable. An annual subscription is less than $10 a month. And if you would like to join the millions of people learning on Skillshare today, and the first 1,000 people to click the link in my description will get a free trial of Skillshare Premium, so you can explore your own creativity. Explore new skills, deepen existing passions, and get lost in creativity with Skillshare's online classes. What you find might just surprise and inspire you. As always, huge thank you to everyone on Patreon that continues to support the channel. You guys are amazing. Really excited for Comic Book Club this month. We're talking about House of M and Avengers Disassembled, which are important comics to read these days for reasons. And if you're a patron, you can also see your name in the credits, see videos early, and you get to check out an exclusive live stream one every month that I do based on your suggestions. So if you've ever thought about it, it is a terrific way to support the channel. I really appreciate it. It's patreon.com/nandovmovies. Also, I've got a podcast, Mostly Nitpicking, where every week me, DJ, and Diggins pick apart a piece of pop culture by looking exclusively at the details. We've been doing a lot of the recent Godzilla movies and King Kong movies leading up to Godzilla v. Kong. And God help us, we're also going to do something about the Snyder Cut when that gets released. So that should be fun. You can listen to us wherever you listen to your podcast. We are at Nitpicking Pod on Twitter. Also, the Nebula Plus content for this video, which is a little bit of something that didn't quite fit into this video, but I did want to talk about, is what the story was when the Blob ate the Wasp. It is a wild story that is a good example of why the Ultimate Universe did not work. So that is on Nebula. Last thing, as always, follow me on Twitter, Instagram, TikTok, Twitch. I've started streaming again, some Apex. I'm Nandovmovies on all of those platforms. That is all I've got. I'll see you next time.